Bei der australischen First Graphene, früher First Graphite, haben sich in den letzten Monaten die Ereignisse überschlagen. Wir konnten mit Executive Director Peter Hewitt sprechen und haben uns die jüngsten Ereignisse genau erklären lassen. Darüber hinaus wollten wir von Herrn Hewitt natürlich wissen, was 2018 von First Graphene zu erwarten ist. Peter, welcome.
Thanks, Bill. Pleasure to be back here.
First Graphene has had a busy couple of months lately, which also got the stock moving again. Let's start with the milestone that probably garnered the most attention, the official opening of your graphene production facility. Please tell us a bit about that. What's the potential capacity, for example? What are your plans there?
Yeah, well, the official opening for the commercial graphene facility was on the 23rd of November. It was opened by Josh Wilson, who is the Member of Parliament, Federal Member of Parliament for Fremantle, which is where Henderson facility is based. The opening was attended by about 40 people and was followed the next day by our annual general meeting. So we had shareholders there and we were able to show them the facility. The facility is being commissioned during the first 2 months of 2018, and its capacity when it was running 24/7 would be between 90 and 100 tons of graphene per annum. When we commission it in that first couple of months of next year, we'll only be operating on day shift though at that point in time.
But only a couple of days after the opening, you already told people that the first deliveries are taking place. What can you tell us about that?
Well, First Graphene had attended the IDTechEx conference in Santa Clara in the first week of November. And as a consequence of attendance at that conference, we had received a purchase order from a cement additives company in the United States who'd also been at the conference, and we supplied them with the product that they'd asked for on the purchase order. We've also been able to send off some samples to manufacturers in Italy and in the United Kingdom, and they're assessing those test samples now as we speak.
Very interesting. But that's what just one side of your business. You're also in several development of research and development collaborations with the Australian universities and manufacturing your or developing your own value-added graphene products. You recently announced that you're being able to produce graphene oxide in an environmentally friendly way. So what exactly is graphene oxide? What is it used for, and what is the potential kind of market opportunity there?
Yeah, well, graphene oxide is almost the inverse of graphene. Graphene oxide has a very high resistivity and is hydrophilic. In other words, it attracts water, whereas graphene has low resistivity, in other words, enormously conductive and hydrophobic. It rejects water. So they're complete opposites. There are two different markets for both of them. And graphene oxide will potentially represent 40% of the total graphene market by 2026. So we have decided to look at doing graphene oxide as well, which will open up that market to potential customers. The work that's being done at Flinders is an environmentally friendly way to produce it because at the moment, under the Hummers or the modified Hummers method, a considerable amount of toxic waste is produced in making the graphene oxide, and we're looking for a way that eliminates that toxic waste being created.
And that would also mean your method would be more cost efficient if you don't have to deal with that.
Well, if you don't have all of that waste to try and dispose of, and that waste is environmentally very dangerous, it contains things such as nitric and sulfuric acid, plus hydrofluoric acid, which is an awful material, and so it's environmentally dangerous and expensive to dispose of. This would make it much more economic to produce graphene oxide.
Very interesting. Now, another area where you've been making headway recently is your fire retardant called Firestop. You seem to be firmly on the road to commercialization there. Please tell us a bit about the product, but tell us also what the market opportunity is there.
Well, with FireStop, it's a graphene-based fire retardant. The fire retardant, in simple terms, works because the graphene provides an oxygen barrier, and as we all know, a fire cannot exist without oxygen. Also, because of the graphene's capacity for heat distribution, it helps to spread the heat load. And also, the structural capacity of the graphene helps to maintain the integrity of the particular structure that might be about to catch fire. The commercialisation aspects of that are particularly exciting. The fire retardant market is worth about $8 billion
Okay.
in 2016. The biggest part of that is in plastics, and that's worth about $5.5, followed by textiles at about $1.1 billion. So we're working on being able to work our way into those particular markets with this particular product.
Very interesting, yes. Also very interesting is your best battery. That's another area you're working on. That's a super capacitor, if I pronounce that
Yes,
correctly.
that's right. So
What's that about?
the best battery is actually a supercapacitor, not a battery as such. The advantage of supercapacitors over existing lithium-ion battery technologies is that they will be able to charge more quickly than a lithium-ion battery. So you would be able to recharge your iPhone, in 30 seconds instead of it taking a couple of hours. It has a much longer life cycle. In other words, it can be charged and discharged far more times than a lithium-ion battery. And as everyone would be familiar with their iPhone or their computer laptop battery, it begins to lose its performance after a number of charges and discharges. So this would overcome that by a factor of at least 200 times. And also, again, from an environmental point of view, disposing of lithium-ion batteries is difficult because of the other parts that are in it, such as the lithium, the cobalt. Because of the physical nature of the supercapacitor, disposal at the end of its life cycle is not environmentally harmful.
Okay, very interesting. So you've got a couple of things going there in parallel. I guess that ties in with you getting on board in mid-September. You announced that I think that Mr. Andy Goodwin would be joining the company as a consultant. Why did you ask Mr. Goodwin to join the company? What do you expect from him?
Yeah, well, Dr. Andy Goodwin's, he's a materials specialist. He's had many years' experience in nanomaterials. Craig and I first met him at the IDTechEd conference in Berlin in 2015, and we had many conversations with him over the intervening period. You could say we stalked him, I suppose, and when he decided to leave his existing employer, we pounced and grabbed him. What we'd really liked about Andy and all the conversations we'd had with him was his extreme knowledge on terms of nanomaterials. He also has considerable business acumen, so it's not just academic. He has a business background, and we liked his business and work ethic. So he makes a really good fit with Craig and I. As I say, we met him 2.5 years ago, and we'd always been keen to have him come to work for us.
Okay. So, and also that he is based in Europe doesn't hurt either. Is that correct?
Huge advantage for us. He's on either the same time zone as a number of companies or on within an hour or so, which is a big advantage over being here in WA. He's already been to Italy and had visits with customers there. He made a visit out here as soon as he'd been employed. That was in October, and visited all the universities. He's now working and liaising with those universities as well. He'll be back in January. That's part of a plan that we have him visit us each quarter, and those trips will include visits to each of the universities and any potential customers we have out in this Asia Pacific region as well.
Okay, thanks. So, after all that flurry of activities in the last 2, 3 months, we would of course like to know what can we expect of first graphene in the new year. Would you, in your personal opinion, think that's a good time to consider taking a position?
Well, to break that into two bits, in the new year we have the commissioning of the commercial graphene facility that will be happening in the first 2 months of the new year. We have further testing that will be undertaken on Firestop, at which point we hope to be able to then submit it to CSIRO for independent testing by the government authority here and move on from there. That's critical to the commercialisation of it. We'll have further developments on the BESS battery and further developments on our graphene oxide with Flinders University and with the other streams of research that we have going on with the University of Adelaide, which includes building products such as cement. With regards to investment, I can't give investment advice, Bourne, but let me just say to you that Craig and I were confident enough that in October we exercised $598,000 worth of options and put that money into the company at a time when the share price was below the 9.2 cent exercise price. So that gives you some idea of the confidence we had in the direction that we were taking.
Okay, thank you very much. That certainly
All right.
sounds
All
interesting. Thank you
right,
for
on
taking
that
time.
note, I wish all of your viewers a happy and safe holiday season, and I look forward to talking to you again early in 2018 and updating you on what we're doing.
Certainly looking forward to that too. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay, thanks.